The briefest introduction for Robert, his work is well known, his books, his articles for The Atlantic. It's especially important tonight to say that he's a senior fellow of the Center for New American Security, our host for this evening, an organization that has made such a mark on every recent administration and the way we think about foreign policy. Whether it will make a mark on the current administration is one of the puzzles that we're going to be thinking about. But I thought I would start our conversation by asking Robert just to explain this interesting title, Earning the Rockies. There's a wonderful passage in this book just to set up this idea, which I'm going to read to the audience and ask you to explain what the title means. But this is actually the way the book ends. We must imagine ourselves forever on the 100th meridian of longitude in Nebraska, where the landscape features sharpen and minimalize in the increasingly thinning air. The water table underneath continues to diminish as we head west. The margin for error narrows. And Robert, tell us what we mean by earning the Rockies.
Earning the Rockies is you don't see the Rockies by flying to Aspen in a private jet and looking at the Rockies. That's not what it means. What you have to do is you have to drive across through the Appalachians, across the flat, tall grass prairie, then across the flat but gradually rising short grass Great Plains, which are really a desert, which is what I mean by the water table diminishes. And because in Nebraska, something a wonderful happens. You start out from Omaha, and you're in the Midwest, and you keep driving west, and it's flat. It stays flat, but you're gradually going up in altitude, and you don't notice it. And suddenly, there are center pivots for agriculture. It's wheat. It's not corn being grown. And the landscape becomes sharper and sharper. And then in western Nebraska, you go into a diner and everyone's got cowboy hats. So you have left the Midwest, you're in the Great Plains, and then another day or so of driving and you hit the Rockies. And after, when you see the Rockies, after spending days of driving across the flat interior continent, it means something very different. It means the barrier. The Rockies is the barrier that the settlers in the early mid-19th century had to overcome in order to get to the West. And in fact, settling the West was our first experience in nation building, before the Philippine War, before the Spanish-American War.
So as you know, if you know Robert's work, and as you just heard, there is this idea through the last several books of geography as destiny. And what makes this book interesting is that although it's rich with intellectual argument, it's also the story of a trip across this amazing country. And maybe you could just describe that trip and talk a little bit about your dad and your dad's inspiration for the trip that you took.
Yes, this book had a very strange origin. I originally wanted to write a book about Bernard DeVoto, who is a great American intellectual and writer for Harper's Magazine in the 30s, 40s, and 50s, and was really one of the intellectual stars of the age, who's now been completely forgotten, and who really interpreted the American landscape in terms of America's responsibility in the world. I also wanted to write about my father. And my father spent the 1930s going around racetracks throughout the United States, working in racetracks during the Depression. And he filled me with, he was a truck driver, he was uneducated, but he read deeply. And he filled me with stories of wonder about the American landscape. So I put my father together with DeVoto, and I said the natural result of that is to drive across America. And if I drive across America, the natural result of that is to think about America's role in the world. So it's an oddly constructed book, in a way. It's a short book that entails a chapter about my father, a chapter about Bernard DeVoto, a chapter of what I call the vertical landscape, which is the east and the tall grass prairie. Vertical because the trees grow tall and therefore the view is very narrow. And then the horizontal landscape, which occurs in mid-Nebraska where the trees stop completely. And from then until you reach the well-watered west near the Pacific, there's nothing to obstruct your view. So you see it horizontally. In a sense.
I want to ask you about your sense of America as faded by geography, as you say in the book, faded to be a world leader. This incredibly rich country, with rivers that allowed us to build up our economic base quickly, rivers emptying into this great ocean basin. It's a picture of a country, huge, rich, blessed in the ways that we all know by our geography. But you conclude from this the opposite of what Americans a century ago did, which was that this rich nation, so abundant, bounded by two oceans, didn't have to be involved in the world. The idea of America first, which has come back with such intensity, it's one of President Trump's most important slogans, that idea began with a geographic description of America that's similar to yours, but a conclusion that's the opposite. Yeah. And I want to ask you to explain your view, why you think this geography makes us fated, our geographical fate is to be a world leader, and then ask you to engage the counterargument. But first, make your case as to why we have to be with this geography engaged in the world.
All right, the United States of America is the temperate zone of the North American continent. It's the last resource-rich part of the temperate zone that was settled during and after the European Enlightenment. And it is the greatest of the island satellites of the Eurasian supercontinent in Africa. So if you put Africa together with Eurasia, which is what a great British geographer, Halford Mackinder, did about 120 years ago, and then you look what else is there, the temperate zone of North America is the most important. So we're protected from the old world. But also, on account of our river system, we have more miles of navigable inland waterways than much of the rest of the world combined. Our rivers unite us because they all flow diagonally towards each other and empty out into the Caribbean, which is into the great sea lines of communication. So that even a city like Pittsburgh, David, on the Ohio River, which empties into the Mississippi, which empties into the Caribbean, was since the 19th century a port, an international port. So we're connected to the old world through our river system, but we're protected from it at the same time because we're an island satellite. And once we gain domination of the greater Caribbean, strategic domination, in the early 20th century, and we did that because all of our rivers and our sea lines emptied in the Caribbean, we became the dominant force in the Western Hemisphere. And once we were the great hemispheric power, we could affect the balance of power in the other hemisphere. And that, I contend, is what the 20th century was all about. In two world wars and the Cold War that followed, it all began with the Caribbean, dominating the Caribbean, the blue water extension of our continental landmass, and the Caribbean began with the river system. So we're protected from the old world, but we're connected to it. It's an ambiguous geography, so people can have disagreements about the degree of our engagement in the world, but I contend that because we're protected and connected at the same time, there's nobody but us who's in the geographical position to shape the world environment in Afro-Eurasia.
So what would be your counterargument to the Trump supporter or conceivably President Trump himself who says, I agree with everything that you just described about America's geographical advantages, but I think we've exhausted ourselves trying to be connected with the world, trying to enforce, you at one point say, semi-order or something, a phrase like that.
Yeah.
And it's time for us to come home. That's been a central part of his message to a country that's exhausted enough to have at least many people embrace it. How would you make the counter argument to that? We're rich, we're privileged by geography, America first.
I would say President Trump, Mr. President, for centuries the British made sure that no one power dominated the European continent. They always balanced all their prime ministers and foreign ministers, Palmerston, whoever, made sure that if Germany got too strong, they sided with France, vice versa, etc. And the British carried this off fairly successfully. And the United States has to, what the United States has to do is to make sure that no one great power dominates Eurasia, the Eastern Hemisphere, the way we continue to dominate the Western Hemisphere. To that extent, we have to be involved in the world, and that gives us equities in Europe, in Russia, in China. Mr. President, we can argue about the degree of engagement, but in a world interconnected, where America First was a slogan that came along when it took 5 days to cross the Atlantic by ocean liner. Now, because of jet airplanes, cyber, et cetera, we don't have that luxury. It would be nice if we did, but we don't. We have to be engaged, and the way we can be engaged that I think all Americans would agree with is to make sure no one power or coalition of powers dominates the other hemisphere the way we have done in ours.
I hope the audience realizes I'm fundamentally in sympathy with Robert's argument, and it's difficult to be the Trump proxy here, but I'm gonna
right.
persist.
Okay.
So there's another point in your book where you say American foreign policy will, and I'm quoting, will always be Wilsonian to some degree, in that all American presidents seek to expand the boundaries of civil society the world over. And I wrote in the margin next to that, really? We have a president now who clearly has very little interest in expanding the boundaries of civil society. In fact, he makes an argument that that's a, you know, to put it bluntly, it's a fool's errand. That's not our job. Our job is to worry about our citizens and our own economic prosperity. So we have been in an era where that was a good definition. Presidents were Wilsonian to some degree. This idea of American exceptionalism and responsibility was part of the liberal international order that we led. But what's your response to the argument that we just turned a page? that we're not that country that saw a Wilsonian obligation. That was yesterday. Today's different.
All right, let me define Wilsonianism. Wilson himself was very nuanced in his beliefs, especially after the semi-failures of Haiti, Mexico, the Philippines, etc., that he lived through. And so Wilsonianism doesn't mean to forcefully, militarily, expand democracy. But one thing every president up until this one has agreed upon is that we try wherever possible and practical to expand the boundaries of civil society. That may mean working with liberal autocrats, like in Oman, like in Jordan, like in Morocco, places that aren't democracies, but we cannot imagine a better government in any of those places than the ones we have now. So it's a very soft kind of liberal internationalism. It's true, we now have a president who's turned the page on that, but I deeply believe that we will come back to this, if you will, age-old formula that both moral interventionists and realists both agree with. Because even realists who are opposed to Bosnia or something like that, even they believed in a kind of soft Wilsonianism. And I think that's what we will come back to, because that's our geographic situation and that's the thrust of American history at a time when we're more and more interconnected with the world. So that geography is not negated, it's just become more claustrophobic. And in such a claustrophobic geography, the best way to ensure our own security is to try to safeguard a civil society in the world, however it's defined, whether under a liberal autocrat or an actual democracy or whatnot.
I want to come back to that challenge of a disordered world and why it compels American involvement. Again, which I agree with, but to stick with my contrarianism, let me offer what I'm going to describe as the Steve Bannon critique.
Okay.
I'm sorry. I know that that's people who want to leave the room can do that, but so. If I understand Bannon's argument, and it's a radical argument. There's a something of the Jacobin, to put it mildly, in him. He would say that this interconnected world that Robert Kaplan describes, the phenomenon of globalization that comes in that interconnected world, the order that we have been living in, is an order that fundamentally benefits the elites in the countries that are part of that global order and does not benefit ordinary people. And so it's time for those ordinary people, the citizens, to revolt, to rebel, to reject this idea of globalization. That, I think, in essence, that is the radical argument. That is the intellectual fuel behind what we're watching. And I'd love to hear you engage that at its essence. I think it's a mistake, just to say one word more, to trivialize the seriousness of that argument. I think it's important to take it on and then, if to the extent possible, rebut it. So I'd ask you, somebody I respect deeply, to engage it and rebut it.
Well, what I would say is that the wave of populism we're seeing around the world now is not a return to nationalism, but the swan song of it. That ultimately, globalization is inexorable because of technology, because of trade, because of, as I said, the shrinking of geography without the disappearance of it. And therefore, we have no other choice but to engage. And we should engage with serious, stable, and like-minded regimes or governments wherever we can. That even for instance, if Marine Le Pen were to win in France, she still has the French Parliament, the Chamber of Deputies, etc. France is more integrated with the EU than even Britain is. So any French exit from Europe is probably not going to happen, and it's going to be far more complicated than it even is in Britain. In Germany, you're likely to get not an alt-right government, but a weakened Merkel with other parties who will refuse to form alliances with the alt-right and who will just have a softer approach than Merkel. You can negotiate with Russia, but that doesn't mean that you still don't have obligations. To NATO. You can say that bringing in the Baltic states was a mistake, but we're past that now, therein, and that we're better off supporting allies. What's a better ally than Japan, really? Japan has a stable democracy. It has no crises. It's building up its military in a very responsible manner. It's rediscovering nationalism, not as populism, but just as an escape from the quasi-pacifism of the past several decades. So when we engage the allies that matter, who've stood by us, Japan, Great Britain, Canada, Australia, and we go beyond Japan and the Anglosphere, and we get to France and Germany, and we're still better off with more conventional governments, because these populists have no answer in the long run. They have no answer, and a world of populism where you shred trade agreements is a world that's more likely to bring us into major interstate conflict. And that world will be worse. Infinitely worse from the point of view of the average citizen. Populism is a good starter, but it's a bad ender 5 years down the road.
That's well said. This swan song of nationalism, if that's what it is, as you were talking, I was thinking of the last act of a Shakespeare play where the stage is littered with corpses. I mean, it's the last act, but it's pretty bloody. There's a passage I'm going to read again from your book that I think is acute, and ask you to elaborate on it. You say at one point, "I'm not describing a world necessarily on the brink of war, but a world that is more crowded, nervous, and anxious than perhaps at any moment in history, even as there remains no power as yet on the horizon with the imperial-like reach of the United States." So you're just describing a world that's having a kind of collective anxiety attack, and you have a United States that for the moment, but this is going to be a long moment, has walked away from its traditional role of leading, calming, organizing. How does that work in a period that, as you say, is more crowded, nervous, and anxious than any moment in history?
I would say that, first of all, the new administration has different elements to it. You have a Secretary of Defense, a Secretary of State, and maybe a new national security advisor coming in who have more traditional views than the president. And our institutions are strong. Look at the courts in the past few weeks. And look at who's running our massive defense and security bureaucracies. We're not Weimar Germany. You can't blow over our institutions like a bunch of matchsticks like Hitler did. I'm not comparing Trump to Hitler. I'm just saying that our institutions are strong. And these institutions, I think, will ultimately moderate the president. And I think we're seeing that already. General Mattis flies to Japan to reassure Japan. The president walks back his change of policy on China, which I assume took place with coordination with both Secretary Mattis and Secretary Tillerson on that. And you know, we know that the Secretary of Defense is committed to defending allies against Russia. And in terms of warning that NATO has to pay more, that began with Secretary Gates, actually. So that is not a radical proposition, especially the way that he phrased it today.
I should note, I agree entirely that a sane world just had a good, on balance, a good week in the reaffirmation of the two essential pillars of stability in Asia. I think the U.S. relationship with Japan is absolutely critical, too often undervalued, and I thought the president's weekend with Shinzo Abe was actually terrific. The idea of this very personal embrace and playing golf, I thought that was excellent. I'll bet it played well at home. And the idea of walking back the initial moves to discount the One China policy and reestablishing that foundation, I thought was, some of that was positive. I'm going to turn to the audience for questions in a minute, but I want to ask you about a couple of geographic framing ideas before we leave this part of our conversation. You say, interestingly, that as we look at China, I'm going to quote your phrase, in geographic terms, that it's geographically apportioned for global power in ways similar to the United States.
Yeah.
And for that reason, I infer, is a potential challenge to the world that you would like to see because of that geographic fundamental. Maybe you could elaborate on that.
China's most northern part is Manchuria, which is at the same latitude as Maine. Its southernmost part, Hainan Island, is at the same latitude as the Florida Keys. So it's in the same temperate latitudes as we are. It's got 9,000 kilometers of coastline on the world's most important sea lines of communication. And in the west, it fronts mineral and hydrocarbon-rich Central Asia. It's not on the Indian Ocean, but it's close enough to it so that it can build up a navy to pass through the Strait of Malacca and be a presence in the Indian Ocean. So that, and what is China doing? It's building what it's called One Belt, One Road. What is that really? It's a way to make an end run around the Turkic Muslim Uyghurs in Western China by having a good security relationship with the former Soviet republics in Kazakhstan, et cetera. And at the same time, by solidifying ethnic Han China's hold on Central Asia, it gives China the luxury to go to sea, which is what the South China Sea and East China Sea crises have been all about. Because China does not have a seafaring tradition, except in the early 15th century for a short time. So China can go to sea and build a great navy precisely because it's secure on land, because it's got this continental landmass in the temperate zone, similar to us. So it's very natural for China to be a great power. I think China's problem is that it has structural economic challenges far greater than we have. And that at the same time that Chinese society is more and more dissatisfied. So China, the last 30 years in China have been dull. Thankfully, China's been run by middle of the road, risk averse technocrats, uncharismatic, making collegial decisions. The next 30 years are going to be more interesting in China, internally speaking. So I'm not convinced of China's stability internally.
Final geographic image that I found really compelling is your description of the zone of contest. I don't want to say conflict, but zone of confrontation between the United States and its allies and Russia as being the intermarium, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, yeah. Which is the zone between the two seas, the Baltic in the north and the Black Sea in the south. And it's fascinating to think of that zone. Obviously, Ukraine, Turkey are interesting points of conflict, contested alignment. But speak a little bit about that zone and what you would say your style of analysis, rooted in geographic fact, tells you about what good policy would be.
Right. The intermarium is the belt of countries starting with Estonia in the north and ending in Bulgaria in the south and taking in Ukraine. It's the small countries historically between Germany and Russia, essentially. And it's those countries that are what is contested. When people say Russia's doing this in the Baltic states, it's doing that in the Ukraine, it's doing that in Syria, it sounds as if it's three separate theaters, but that's not how I think of it. I think the Russians have a much more organic sense of geography than we do. And for them, from whether it's the Baltics or Syria or Ukraine, it's all the near abroad. And it's the region where Russia has to regain some form of soft imperial influence in order to replicate the Soviet Union on the cheap, without doing it the way it was in the Cold War, where it was outright occupation through friendly communist parties. That didn't work. It was too expensive. That's not what Putin is trying to do. He wants a zone of a traditional zone of imperial influence there. And what should we do? One thing we should not do, we should not have a rapprochement with Russia that allows Russia to continue subversion in these places. What is Russian subversion? It's buying media through third parties, running intelligence operations, buying off corrupt politicians. All these things that Russia does in the Baltic states, in Bulgaria, in Slovakia and Hungary, etc. Because if we have a more friendly rapprochement with Russia, and the Russians could see this as a green light to even increase this activity, and then one day we'll wake up 5 years from now and the Baltic states, though technically members of NATO, and Bulgaria, technically member of NATO, just to use an example, will wake up and it'll all be hardline pro-Russian prime ministers and governments and media, etc. That's already happening in Moldova. It's starting to happen in Bulgaria already.
So I take from that that your policy prescription would be that in this zone, in this intermarium, we should contest Russian efforts to regain hegemony.
Yes, but remember, Russia's not doing this militarily, and neither should we, actually. This is where all.
But we have a military, and that's what NATO is. I mean,
yes.
NATO isn't it's not a club.
No, it's not a club. But Russia's form of operation in these countries is subversion. Yes, it has tens of thousands of troops to the east of the Baltic states in the Kola Peninsula around there. But its principal element is intelligence activities, organized crime, etc. And so one of our elements besides basically undoing what President Obama did by withdrawing the two brigade combat teams in 2012, undoing that, which Secretary Ashton Carter started doing that, which didn't get enough attention in my regard, is to use all of our diplomatic civil society, intelligence, other levers that are non-military to contest Russia in these places. You know, restationing troops near there is not going to be enough.
I wish we had General Mattis here to engage us in this conversation, but we're going to have to turn the audience instead of General Mattis. Do we have questions? Yes, please. And if perhaps you could identify yourself, keep the questions short, and questions, please.
I'm Amar Basti Khan. I'm from Balochistan. I'd like to ask you, there is a perception that the United States is a power in decline. And here we see the Mexican wall coming up. Do you see the Mexican wall as a symbol of a power that is in decline?
The Mexican war, you mean the new
wall?
Wall, excuse me.
I heard that as war initially also.
Yeah, all right. I think that over the course of the decades, Latin history continues to move north. Demographically, in terms of our culture, et cetera. Actually, there has been very little, to my knowledge, Mexican immigration to the United States in the last few years. Very little, actually. And I think that that a wall cannot stop the it cannot stop the march of history, and it wouldn't. And by a wall, I mean a strengthened border regime. Let me answer the question this way: in 2004, the late Harvard professor Sam Huntington wrote a book called "Who Are We," which got panned and trashed by all the critics. And the book said that Mexican immigration is out of hand, and the elites are becoming global cosmopolitans, not American nationalists. And there will be a populist backlash, essentially. And nobody believed him at the time, because he published the book 13 years ago. And he got it right, but I think that the danger of Mexican immigration is already past us, actually. There's very little of it now, and I don't see it as a power in decline. I see a future, this is contrary to President Trump, I see a future of a kind of a Mex-America in the Southwest, in the northern third of Mexico, where the U.S. dollar is legal currency, that enhances U.S. power rather than diminishes it.
The gentleman all the way, yes, sir, with a hat in the back.
Thank you very much. My name is Yaya Fanusi. I'm with United States of Africa 2017 Project Task Force, LLC. When you talk about leadership, American global leadership, one thing you all should think about, how the rest of the world who don't look like you people think about what you're doing. So what I want you to think is, did we, who don't look like you, like people, the 1 billion people in Africa, endorse in a referendum or plebiscite that United States should lead them? I want you to start thinking about that. It's about to over, and we're going to get Trump to stop that.
Robert?
Yeah. In 1998, I published a book, An Empire Wilderness, Another Travel Journey Across America, where I said America will eventually become a Polynesian mestizo society due to immigration from Mexico, from Asia, from all over the world, and that the United States will come to resemble the world visually, in every other way. And I provided all these statistics answers to it. I think that one of the uncovered trends ongoing is the Africanization of Europe that's going to happen in the next few decades. Because Middle East migration to Europe is generated by war, but African migration is generated by development. Because when you have development, from backbreakingly poor societies to lower middle class societies. That doesn't keep people there. It gives them the opportunity to leave, to go elsewhere. And so if you think that Africa has a population, sub-Saharan Africa, I mean, of like 1.1 billion now, and it will go up to 3 billion or 4 billion by the end of the century, and Europe's population is stagnant, we're going to see a dramatic shift in Europe. It's going to be too slow to fit into the strictures of news headlines because it won't be a dramatic development. It will be very, very gradual. But what's happening around the world, in Europe, in America, is a gradual, through migration, a racial homogenization.
The woman, yes, in the fourth row. Yes, please.
Thanks, Kate Bateman. I'm a visiting fellow at CNAS. There's the recent public polling data of Americans shows that actually there's really strong support for strong U.S. leadership in the world, in maintaining strong alliances. And then you compare that with some research that James Fallows has cited that shows Americans are generally, especially in small towns, are generally more confident and more optimistic about their own community life than that perhaps of at the national level. So I'm wondering if you think that we might be overlearning a bit from the election, that the American public is in sync with the Trump administration's views about American power in the world or our role in the world. And I'm wondering also what you heard from Americans on your trip, on your drive across the country, what kind of foreign policy did they want us to have?
What I learned was, listening to people, was that Americans don't want another 9/11, and they don't want another Iraq war. Between those two extremes, they're not concerned with the details. The same days that the elites were arguing about the Iranian nuclear pact, or about Jeb Bush's misstatements on Iraq, nobody was talking about it. And that's not just me. That there was a story in Politico at the same time about this. The reporter went around and interviewed people at an Indianapolis mall, and nobody even knew about the Iranian negotiations there. I find that Americans are united by their worries when you hear people talk. They talk about their back problems, their financial problems, so you know the difficulty of supporting elderly parents, some with Alzheimer's. I found a lot of alienation of people who were, they didn't talk politics, but the conversation was filled with life's anxieties, essentially, with no discussion of politics, because I made this journey before the start of the primary campaigns. The journey was made in 2015 in the spring. This was about 9 months before the primary campaigns and about 8 months before then private citizen Donald Trump even erupted into the news. But if you think of Trump as a sort of anti-politics, it kind of makes sense. People united by their worries, with anxieties, and yet at the same time not discussing politics, that adds up to alienation. So, you know, someone comes along and loses the popular vote, but becomes president by a very, very narrow margin, maybe 100,000 votes swinging this way or that in three Midwestern states. And yes, it may be that we're overlearning this, but this is our system. This is the president we have.
It is striking the contrast between the America that you described, certainly the America that Jim Fallows and his wife Deb have been encountering in their travels, which is still a pretty abundant, hopeful country. In Jim's case, you describe a place more alienated, but not this seething nation of Steve Bannon like rage at the elites. That doesn't come
That's
through
not
here.
What I found. But what I did find was beyond the coasts, beyond the college and university towns, beyond cities here and there like Des Moines, Iowa, which are very impressive and pulsing with all kinds of new activity. Beyond that, things are pretty depressed in many places, economically speaking.
So the gentleman in the second row, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thanks very much. My name is Shane Mason. I'm a researcher at the Stimson Center. I really enjoyed reading this book, and I particularly enjoyed your previous book on Romania. So if you maybe speak about the geopolitical importance of Romania in American foreign policy and maybe what's happening now. I see that there's a lot of protests of the current government.
Yeah, you've had several hundred thousand people in downtown Bucharest, not for a few days, but for 3 weeks now, all demonstrating against corruption, for civil society, the rule of law, for the EU, and these demonstrations have spread to Moldova, they've spread to Bulgaria. You essentially have massive pro-EU, pro-rule of law demonstrations in Romania and a little bit in adjacent countries that have come under the radar screen. There's no discussion of it. Now imagine, this is how elections matter. Imagine if Hillary Clinton had won and there was already a dynamic new Assistant Secretary of State for Europe in place. That person would now be in Bucharest shaking hands with the demonstrators, and the elite would be covering it. Whereas now, there's a lot of coverage on it in Politico Europe, for instance, and in some on Real Clear World, there were like five pieces just in the last 2 days on it. But because of the melodrama in the White House and the NSC, it's kind of blocked it out. It's kind of taken all the oxygen out of the news system. So this historical event, these are the greatest demonstrations since 1989 in this part of the world, has essentially gone under the radar screen.
That's fascinating. I'd make a similar observation about the Arab world, which I have been traveling in for decades now, that kernel of the assertion of ordinary people in the Arab world, I'm a citizen, I'm not going to live under a police state any longer, I have rights, I'm connected, which we associate with the Arab Spring, is still alive and powerful, and we tend to forget it as we look at this nightmarish spread of violence and extremism. There was a hand in the second row. Yes, please.
My question is related to the Arctic. In the context of geography matters, appreciate if you would share your perspectives of nation states, China, Russia, vis-a-vis the Arctic Ocean. Thank you.
Vis-a-vis the Arctic Ocean.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, it's more interesting to discuss it in terms of Russia, I would say, which is, the northern coast of Russia is ice blocked several months of the year. If you have continued global warming, this helps Russia. It also is one of the reasons why Norway is increasing its military budget. Norway is becoming a significant Arctic military power. We don't think of Scandinavia in this way, but think of Norway as a budding military power, of Sweden with one of the best man-for-man submarine forces in the world. And a lot of this has to do with the increasing importance of the Arctic Ocean at a time of of rising temperatures in the region. But I wouldn't take this too far. Because Let me tell you, the Northwest Passage is still ice blocked, you know, to significant degrees. I have a friend, a sailor friend, who got stuck there 2 years ago in August because of the ice. I think this is an advantage for the leadership in Russia, but considering all their other problems, I'm just not sure how it's going to play out.
The gentleman here in the first row, and then
Thank you. Jonathan Ward, University of Oxford. Bob, thank you for your talk. It's really a beautiful book. And I wanted to ask you, just combining some of your thinking on Asia's Cauldron and Earning the Rockies. I mean, in Asia's Cauldron, you'd sort of gotten to the idea of Chinese interests in the South China Sea being something like U.S. interests in the Caribbean during our time. But here you've reiterated that. You've got some very interesting passages on China. And I'm just wondering if your trip across America led to any new thinking on China as a rising power, particularly as you rearticulate the idea of sort of the Mackinder, world island and that sort of thing. Thank you.
I think what I learned...
People heard the question about what Robert's trip across America suggested about China as the rise of China.
Yes. What I found was the greatest geography in history for the sake of projecting power, driving across America. If you think about it, I mentioned already the abundant river system, the temperate zone climate, and I spoke also about China. China's advantages. But look at China. China is surrounded by the Korean Peninsula in the northeast, with all of its problems. China doesn't like the regime in North Korea, though it's forced to defend it. It is just not willing to topple it because it doesn't want 2 million refugees across the Yalu and Tumen rivers into Manchuria. China's had border disputes, historical disputes with Russia, that go back decades and centuries even. Russia can never be a strategic friend of China. It could be a tactical ally here and there. China has India on the south. It has Southeast Asia, the Vietnamese, who fought, in my count, about 17 or 18 wars against the Chinese. It has the Turkic Uyghur Muslims in the west, the Tibetans in the southwest, the Inner Mongolians in the north central. China is surrounded by foes, by historical foes. When China looks out at sea, it sees a great wall in reverse, a great wall of American allies. Japan, South Korea, Taiwan, the Philippines a bit iffy now, but all the way down, all the way down to south, to Australia. America doesn't have those geographical problems. Where to the north is the Canadian Arctic, given that almost all Canadians live within a 100-mile band north of the border. And its only geographic challenge is with Mexico and Central America to the south, which has a comparatively younger, faster growing population, but even Mexican population growth has been declining in recent years. And the Mexican economy has been growing, though not as much as it could or should have.
So we're close to the end of our time. I'm going to take three final questions and then ask Robert to make his final comments. First, Mitzi in the first row, and then this gentleman here. I'll go all the way back to the gentleman with the yellow tie.
I want to congratulate both of you for an absolutely fabulous evening, and I loved your column this morning, David. The thing that I am struck by is how wonderful these stories are, but the American public doesn't understand them. So my question to both of you, who are communicators, how do we communicate this to the non-elite?
Good question.
All right,
the gentleman here, let's hold off, and then we'll come back to Robert. Yes, sir.
Thanks a lot, Mr. Ignatius, and thank you very much for your forum with Secretary Johnson, his exit series at Post Live three quick ones. What is the Trump doctrine?
Because I don't know that we have time for three, but do one big one.
Okay. Okay, pretty big one. How could it be that Western liberalism is defined by a junky numbers cruncher who is a preacher's kid from East Germany? I mean, look at the irony of Angela Merkel representing sort of the Western philosophy and Western perspective in a sort of waning U.S. Standing. Thanks.
Good. Quite glad we have a question about Germany. And then, yes, sir.
The woman up front stole my question, so I'll come with the second one really quick. I would argue that it's a lot easier to destabilize the world, in Russia's case, or China's case, or ISIS's case, than it is to reinforce the rules-based liberal world order. So I don't know if you have any lessons for how America can, if you agree with that, and if you have any lessons for how America can, I guess, better engage the world.
So those are three interesting final questions. How to communicate to the world, to the non-elites in America. What about Germany? How is it that Angela Merkel is she the leader of the liberal order? What's left of it? And then finally, how should we engage the world better?
Communicating with the non-elites is to write as clearly, as simply as possible. That's writing simply is harder than writing in a complicated fashion. That is a whole other debate. But one of the issues that I deal with directly in the book, and it's one of the main themes of the book, is we have to bring back writers like Bernard DeVoto, Wallace Stegner, and Walter Prescott Webb, who wrote clearly and simply for a general audience and were essentially liberals of the kind that don't exist anymore, and totally grasped America's geographical situation and what it meant for American history and America's involvement in the world. On Angela Merkel, my fear is the opposite, that Angela Merkel may be the last of the Adenauer-style chancellors. The last of a line of Adenauer-style chancellors in German history. By that I mean who have an obligation and an historical memory from the World War, stemming from the end of World War II throughout the Cold War and afterwards, that we're about to embark eventually upon a new generation of German leaders who I fear will be much more ahistorical and will not have this same deeply embedded memory. Remember, she grew up in East Germany, in Rostock. She speaks Russian, so she knows Putin's game. She's been a much tougher negotiator with Putin than anyone would have thought 5 years ago. I think if you have, you know, frustrations with Merkel, wait to see what follows her in that sense. And on destabilization, it's true. Russia is playing the spoiler now in Serbia, Bulgaria, in many places, and it's doing it on the cheap, in Montenegro, in places on the cheap. It's not throwing around a lot of money. It's running, there was an aborted Russian coup attempt in Montenegro a few months ago that was reported in the American Interest very expertly. So this is a challenge. I remember during the Cold War, we had the American Information Service. What was the name?
USIA.
USIA. We had a whole gamut of agencies that dealt with the soft side of power projection. And I think that's an element that we really have to bring back. And this is not contradictory, but goes along with having a robust intelligence system, because intelligence, information in this world is, you know, that's a battlefront.
So we're going to bring it to a close. This, I must say, this evening, restores my sense that the world's going in the right direction. This is a wonderful discussion, intellectually rich,
This is a really fun book to read. I'll say that again. But please join me in thanking the author, Robert Kaplan.
Thank you. Thank you.